In this video, we'll take a look at what it takes to create and execute a web load test. To create a load test scenario, you can use the recorder application. The recorder makes it possible to capture HTTP requests and thus create a scenario by clicking around in the browser window. First of all, you need to set the domain you want to test, and then press Start Recording. Set the name of the first transaction of the test scenario, for instance, homepage. Click Start Transaction and visit the homepage of the tested website in the browser window opened by the recorder. When the page loads, you can stop the transaction. You can see all the requests related to the transaction. You can repeat this process for the second transaction. That is, set the name of the transaction, press Start Transaction, carry out the respective action in the browser, and after the page loads, click Stop Transaction. When your test scenario is complete, click Stop Recording. Then click Create and Edit Test. A window with the test which has been created opens, where you can make all sorts of necessary edits, such as setting the number of virtual users, load shape and duration, ramp up times, or more advanced settings such as assertions or automatic correlations. Moving now to the remote desktop, where we start the distributed load test using what we call the controller, which controls several load generators spread out over several different servers. These servers are used to generate a sufficient and realistic load on the tested website. 1,000 virtual users created on 5 separate generators in this case. In the controller, we can monitor real-time test results. The graph on the right shows the number of hits per second. The graph on the left shows response times. In the table, there's a summary of statistical data. In the top right corner, the number of users currently in the test is displayed. The number of users grows gradually. In the top left corner, the elapsed runtime and number of errors are displayed. Now we will take a look at the test's progress. The graphs show that the system's condition worsens, and its response starts to grow slower. The number of hits grows as well as the number of virtual users, which is a good sign. The servers are still able to process these hits. The tested system starts to falter. The response time is now about 20 seconds, which is really an irritatingly long time for a user to wait, and it grows drastically. Now we're in the second half of the test, with slightly more than 500 virtual users. The number of requests on the server is decreasing because the server is no longer able to process them. Although there are no errors yet, response time is almost 1 minute, and we can expect timeouts anytime soon. We can see that errors start to appear. A second timeout exception occurs. The maximum number of virtual users we have set has now been achieved. There are 1,000 virtual users currently using the tested website. New errors keep on popping up. It is time to stop the test and generate an automatic test report. The test report consists of statistical data, such as a summary of successful and failed requests and of responses. Here we can see that there have been 24 socket timeout exception errors. There are also a lot of relevant graphs to help analyze system performance in more detail. We will talk more about analyzing these graphs in another video.